Blackstone Audio presents The Histories by Caius Cornelius Tacitus, translated by W. H. Fife, first published in A.D. 105. Book 1. I propose to begin my work with the year when Servius Galba was consul for the second time and Titus Vinius was his colleague. Many historians have dealt with the 820 years of the earlier period, beginning with the foundation of Rome, and the story of the Roman Republic has been told with equal eloquence and independence. After the Battle of Actium, when the interests of peace were served by the centralization of all authority in the hands of one man, that literary genius fell idle. At the same time, truth was shattered under a variety of blows. Initially, it was ignorance of politics, which were no longer a citizen's concern. Later came the taste for flattery, or, conversely, hatred of the ruling house. So, between malice on one side and civility on the other, the interests of posterity were neglected. But historians find that flattery soon incurs the stigma of slavishness and earns for them the contempt of their readers. Whereas people readily open their ears to slander and envy, since malice gives the false impression of independence. From Galba, Otho, and Vitellius, I have experienced nothing either to my advantage or my hurt. I cannot deny that I owe the launching of my career to Vespasian, or that I was advanced by Titus and still further promoted by Domitian. But those who lay claim to unbiased accuracy must speak of no man with either hatred or affection. I have reserved for my old age, if life is spared to me, the reigns of the deified Nerva and of the Emperor Trajan, which afford a richer and a safer theme. For it is the rare fortune of these days that a man may think what he likes and say what he thinks. The story I now commence is rich in vicissitudes, grim with warfare torn by civil strife, a tale of horror even during times of peace. Four emperors slain by the sword, three civil wars, often entwined with these, an even larger number of foreign wars. Successes in the east, disaster in the west, disturbance in Illyricum, disaffection in Gaul. The conquest of Britain immediately given up, the rising of the Sarmatian and Suebic tribes. Dacia had the privilege of inflicting and receiving defeat at our hands, and a pretender claiming to be Nero almost deluded the Parthians also into declaring war. Now, too, Italy was smitten with new disasters, or disasters it had not witnessed for a long period of years. Towns along the rich coast of Campania were swallowed by the earth or buried from above. The city was devastated by fires, her most ancient temples were destroyed, and the Capitol itself was fired by Roman hands. Sacred rites were grossly profaned, and there was adultery among the great. The sea swarmed with exiles, and cliffs were red with blood. Worse horrors reigned in the city. To be rich or well-born, to hold office or refuse it, was a crime. Merit of any kind meant certain ruin. Nor were the informers more hated for their crimes than for their prizes. Some carried off a priesthood or the consulship as their spoil, others won administrative office and a place at the heart of power. The hatred and fear they inspired worked universal havoc. Slaves were bribed against their masters, freedmen against their patrons, and if a man had no enemies, he was ruined by his friends. However, the period was not so utterly barren as to yield no examples of heroism. Mothers accompanied sons in flight, wives followed husbands into exile. One saw here a kinsman's courage and there a son-in-law's devotion. Slaves obstinately faithful even on the rack, distinguished men bravely facing the utmost straits and matching in their end the famous deaths of older times. Besides these manifold disasters to mankind, there were portents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.